The only God. Well, don't for being here. It's good to see everybody. I'm real excited about tonight's class. It's going to be over Cherokee language and reading the syllabary chart. I think we kind of, sometimes we put the cart before the horse, so to speak. And sometimes we dive in, and that's good to start learning language. But for the longest time, I lurked at this chart and couldn't figure it out. And because you tend to want to read down, but it's actually not that way. And our speaker tonight, I've taken classes with him. He was my first language teacher. And I remember the word gwe. And he would say, "It's not gwe, it's gwe." And I went, "I'm not hearing it." So I want him to really talk about those differences tonight and how to read the chart. Because once you read the chart, you can start putting words together yourself. And so so I want to go ahead and introduce Dennis Sixkiller. And he is a national treasure for language in 2015. He's the host of Cherokee Voices and Cherokee Sounds, a radio show for 12 plus years. He's been an employee of the Cherokee Nation for 26 years. And he has taught numerous community language classes all over our 14 county area. And that's where I met him. He was my first Cherokee language teacher during the what is still taught at the Cherokee Heritage Center, the Cherokee Humanities course. And he was a wonderful teacher. I learned a great deal from him. And at that time, worked with Eli No Fire. And I just really look back on that time with good memories and good learning. He's been a part of as the Speakers Bureau and the Language Consortium for over 10 years now. And that's where our speakers get together once a month, every second Thursday. Every second Thursday here in Tahlequah, and they talk about words and try to come up with new words for what will fit today. And so we can use that in our language programs and with our kids. And so that's also includes the Language Consortium, where that bureau meets with the Eastern Band of Cherokees, the United Kituwa Band, four times a year. And they all get together and work on these words as well. So they've been doing that for over 10 years now, and Dennis has been an amazing part of that and an excellent host and MC. And so it's really, really amazing to watch him in that role. Recently, he was featured on OCO TV, so look for that. He's married to Carol, and they have two children and five grandchildren, and he is from the J. Piney community. Dennis, it's an honor to have you here. Wado.
Wado. All right. Enough already. Okay. I want to say this. I was always a speaker. Grew up, that was my first language. Cherokee was, and because in the home, it was all Cherokee. And it was kind of hard, a little bit hard when I started school, trying to understand the teacher, what they were saying, you know. Kind of like this. So, like, how you doing this? How are you doing? One. You see, that's how it was in school. I asked how many of you, if I talked Cherokee, how many would you understand? Just one understood. That's how it was for a lot of our children growing up. And we all grew up talking Cherokee at home. Then we went to school. It was all English, and we were lost sometimes, and it's kind of hard to catch up and everything. But mom and dad always talk among themselves. To this day, I think I can honestly say that they never talked to each other in English. It's always in Cherokee, even till the day my dad died, and he died when I was 18, right after I graduated from high school. And he passed away. And mom passed away 5 years ago this past January, so she was around for a lot longer than my dad was. And so every time I had a question about a Cherokee word, I just call her up, but now I can't call her up, so I got some elders around here that I can talk to and ask them about certain things too. And then, but anyway, I was going to say a while ago, in school, now they start, four-year-olds, I think, Head Start, early Head Start, and that kind of stuff, but we didn't have those when I was in school, when I grew up, and it was first grade, and second on to senior and everything. But a child, nowadays they'll learn maybe at the age of four, the ABCs. But me, I didn't learn this syllabary chart until 2001. I could always talk it, I could speak it, but I never really learned how to read and write this until 2001. And my first cousin, Anna, she's the one that taught me. she was teaching a class, and I said, Dennis, you know how to read and write Cherokee, don't you? And I was walking in the hallway at the complex over here, and I said, no, I don't. And I had taken a Cherokee class under Durbin Feeling before, but I didn't learn very good. I wasn't a very good student. And but anyway, he did all in Cherokee. He was teaching all in Cherokee. And I probably learned maybe two or three lines, but 3 or 4 years went by, I wasn't using it, and I forgot. And then when Anna called me and said, come down, I'm teaching class down the old jailhouse. No, the whatever it was called back then, right next door to it. But anyway, she was teaching there, and so I said, yeah, I'll come down there. So it was a 15-week course and 4 hours each night. And Donnie mentioned Eli Nofar. Me and him was kind of partnering up because you had to pick a partner in that class. And so it was about 13 weeks I went through. But you know, I already told myself, I told my wife, I'm going to learn. This time I'm going to learn. Like they want to go sail. And that's when I learned. And actually, there's different ways of learning the syllabary. And give you a good little story about my mom, how she learned. And she always had a desire to learn because she would see her dad reading a book. And there's a Bible. And whenever he lay down, he'd be out there on a stump reading Cherokee. And whenever he finished, he'd just lay on a stump. And she'd run over there and try to read, but she couldn't make nothing out of it. To her, it was Greek, you know, but actually it was Cherokee. But anyway, she couldn't read it. So she always wanted to learn. And so she said, asking people, how do I learn? How can I learn? One of her brothers said, well, go to the Gospel of John, the Bible. Go to the Gospel of John, first chapter. Right in there, you can learn from there. Just pick and choose from there, you know. No, but she tried that. Said she didn't learn. She might learn a little bit. But then somebody else had put that Bible under your pillow, hadn't I? No. Maybe it'll soak into your mind or whatever. She tried that. That didn't work. So then at the age of 17, she said one day, and she's always praying, asking God to teach her. And at the age of 17, she finally, one day she opened that Bible up, and she said those words jumped out at her. And just like that, she learned. Every page she turned, boy, she said she ran and told her parents, I learned. But anyway, that's how she learned. And the others, they learned overnight. They learned overnight. Me, it took me a long time. I was hard-headed, you know. I was kind of slow, and it took me a while. But to get started, we have does anybody know how long it took Sequoia to come up with the syllabary chart? Anybody know? How long it took Sequoia? You go ahead, do Celia's on. They was on that. It took him 12 years. 12 years. It took him 12 years to come up with this. But when he first began, he had well over 150 characters. He was trying to put every sound in there that he heard when he was talking Cherokee, but there was way too many. So he came up with the one that was 86. And just a few years ago, this ma right here in line 5, column 6, ma was added, which about maybe 5 years ago, up in Easter Bend, the tri-council met, and they okayed it. So that was put back in there about 5 years ago. Because it was gone for years and years. And this NAH, this N-A-H, 6-1-C, we call it, and that was in there until not too long ago either. That was put back in there. So anyway, that happened then. But going back to the way I learned, it took 15 weeks, and she used to, we kind of studied the syllabary. And starting off, I consider these the first line on top row. And there's just six sounds and vowels in Cherokee. They're aw. Would you repeat them with me? Aw. Aw. E. O. U. Okay, it says aw. E. O. U. Six vowel sounds, and they always stay constant in every Cherokee word you ever come across. They always have that sound, because the A is never E, the E is never A, and vice versa, and so forth. So it's always that sound, A, A, E, O, U, A. Okay, six sounds. And the column 1, this right here, if you look on your chart, you want to follow along on your own charts. In column 1, all these characters right here, from line 1 to 13, and they all make aw sounds. They all make aw sounds. Aw sounds. Do you know how can go? Do they go? Except the one 8-1-B, we call it. Just regular S sound, like in English, just a S sound. Okay, but the rest of them, they make aw sounds. Okay, Then column two, these are a sounds. All these are a sounds. You got a, did it? They go where? They all say a. Then column three, they're e. They all make e sounds. E. All these right here. Then column four, top to bottom, they all make o sounds. O. All these right here, the o sound. Then the u is five. All these characters make u sounds. Then column six, top to bottom, they make a sounds. So now you have a column, a column, e column, o column, u column, and a column. A, a, e, o, u, a. And just like in English or any other language, all you do is put the letters together to make sounds, right, and to make words, phrases, and so forth. So, in other words, if I said, the key to learning this is, you have your English words right here in phonetics beside the Cherokee characters. If I asked you to find haw, where would you find it? Name, line, and column. Haw, the H-A symbol. Where would you find on a syllabary chart?
Row one.
Column one. Three. A. Or 3-1, however you want to put it, okay? 3-1, and that's haw, okay? So when you hear a sound, okay, I'm going to tell you ni, N sound, right? Ni. And all you got to do is go to your N sound, then a, a, e, then just match them up, okay? So ni, it'd be this one right here. These are na sounds, na, and ni. So this is e, ni, okay? And that's how you find it. And my name in Cherokee is Mo-si. Now, you heard the M sound, Mo, not curly or Larry, but Mo, okay? Mo, Mo, okay? So you find Mo, so go here. Here's A, 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 E, O. So there you have, Mo. And that starts my name in Cherokee, Mo. Then C, C, okay? Go to your S sounds on your left side. Line 8, so you have A, A, E. So now you have Mo-si, Mo-si. That's my Cherokee name. And what's your Cherokee? Do you have a Cherokee name?
My wife's name is
Selin. Selin?
Selin.
Selin. Selin.
Selin.
Solly is persimmon. Solly. Selin. Selin. It'd be... Go to your S's, A, A, Se, that'd be her first character on her name. Se, Li, La, Le, Li, so Se, Li, then the N, what go, that Ni, Ni, Se, Li, Ni, that's it. Just three characters, Se, Li, Ni. Se, Li, Ni, be Se, Li, Ni, okay, Se, Li, Ni. All right, so that's how you make words. And if I said a-don, a-don, where's the a sound on the syllabary chart? Very first one.
First column.
Mm-hmm. A, where is da, da? Be the same column, but only the D, okay, the D. Uh-huh, ni. 9-1-A. So now you have a da, and that's a wood in Cherokee. That's word for wood. Okay. So what you do is go down the line, hear your vowel sounds, and line 2 to 13, they're all your consonant sounds. And I want you to stay with me, okay? Line 2, first one is ga, ga, hard G sound with a, and you're down the consonant sound with the vowel sounds up here. You see? So we have ga. Say with me if you would. Ga, ka, ge, gi, go, gu, ga. But, see these two characters in line two? Ga and ka. So that gives you a clue that these words, characters, will change depending on Cherokee word. It can be a ge, or it can be a ke. Ge or ke. Two sounds, same symbol. Gi or ki. Go or ko. Gu or ku. Gu or ka. Okay, so when I first started learning how to read Cherokee, next I would read my Bible, and I'd come across some of these words, and I remember the G sounds, but I forgot they changed the K sounds, even though I was a speaker, and that would really throw me off and kind of get frustrated. And I said, man, I'm not learning. I'd close it back, and then after a while, I said, man, I better start again. So I go back, and finally I figured, I said, I'm forgetting this. Those are interchangeable. You see, it depends on the Cherokee word. You see, you can say this, a ge or ke, okay? You say, ge-in. Ge-in is the word. What's the word? Don't just use ge-in.
Downstream.
Ge-in, that's downstream. Ge-in, that's downstream. Or if I said this, ke-ho-gi. See, ge and ke, same character. Ke-ho-gi, that's a woman's name. Ke-ho-gi. You see, I had an aunt by that name. So if I use a downstream or a woman's name, same character with the G and K sounds, okay? Same thing is gi, gi, gi-li, gi-li. And what is that? Lassie. No. No, that's a dog. Gi-li. Or kilo. I can say kilo. Not kilo, but kilo. Alright? Kilo. That means someone. Okay? Kilo means someone. Same character, you see. And the go, go huele, like paper. Go huele, there's a G sound. Or kohia, kohia, same character. It means after a while. Kohia means after a while. Okay, so same character, G and K sounds. Gu, here's one, u, gu, ku. U, gu, ku. And what is that? U, gu, ku. Hoot owl, you see. U, gu, ku, you see. G and K sounds right there, you see. Then gu, like guna, guna. What's that? Anybody know that one? Guna.
Turkey.
Turkey, okay. Or how about kushli? Kushli. Give you a clue, Rory.
Raccoon,
there you go. Or a bandit, no, or raccoon. Okay, see, ga, gana, or kushli. See, G and K sound, same character. Okay, so it's interchangeable. So when you see two in one column, that means the rest of them are going to be interchangeable depending on the Cherokee word, okay?
It means the same.
What's that?
It means the same if it's interchangeable, it doesn't change the meaning of the word?
Well, the words I gave, they're different meanings, totally different meanings. I'm just saying that they make the same sound. G and K are for the same word, but they have different sound, but it's same spelling. Okay, that's what it is. Okay, then line three, there's regular H sounds. Okay, ha, he, he, ho, who, huh. Okay, line four, just regular L sounds. La, le, li, lo, lu, le. Line five, M sounds. There you go. That's good. Now these are kind of tricky. Line six, this one's just regular NA sound, like na. Then this one's nasalized sound, na, na. Can you say that? It's not hana, but it's na, na. Make sure your nose is clear, okay? We say that. No, okay? No, no. Okay? And then, no. And this one's kind of like you hear the hard, the H is emphasized at the very end. No. Like what's going to give you this? I say, no.
No.
You see, I'm handing you, no. Here. See, that means no. That's that word right there. It's right here. No. Okay? Then we have ne. Or it can be ne sometimes, the nasalized sound, okay? Ne, ni, ni, no, no, nasalized sound, nu, nu, na or na. Here's a good example of that. Na. Well, I don't have no markers over here, do I? I've got some right here. Let me give you an example of that, okay? Uh-oh. Somebody's been messing my... There it is. Okay. That na right here, I use this one as an example. It's ga, na, na. See? There's a H sound. It's kind of aspirated sound. Ga, na, na. See, same character. See, but it's a na and na. Ga, na, na. Like a road. Okay, it means road. Okay, that means a road. Ga, na, na. See, same character, but na and na. Nasalized sound. Okay, first one is regular in the sound. Na. The next one is na. Nasalized sound. Ga, na, na. Okay? So sometimes you're going to run across that with the N sounds. Okay? Sometimes they're nasalized sound. Okay? Then the line 7 is just a regular Q sound. Qua. Que. Qui. Quo. Qu. Qu. But on the Q sound, sometimes you can hear the G sound, and sometimes the K sound too, with that qua. Okay? So you might want to mark that or make a note of it somewhere, because sometimes you can hear those sounds, okay? That the G and K sound, the Q sound. Okay? If I say a person like Ben, Gwen, Gwenny. See, there's kind of like a G sound right there. Or if I say Quana, like a K sound, but it's actually a Q sound for a peach, Quana. Okay? So you're going to run across some words like that too. So we have again the same, Qua, Que, Qui, Quo, Quu, Qua. Do you see what we're doing here? All we're doing is on the consonant sounds with the vowel sounds. A, E, I, O, U, U. Okay? Qua, que, qui, quo, qu, qu. Those sounds go across like that, okay? A, E, I, O, U, U. Okay? Then line 8. First one is a saw, saw. Then the next one, same column. Just regular S sound, just a S sound like in English, okay? Then the next one is say, see, so, sue, su. Then line 9. Here we go. Two characters right here. Da. Wait, let me back up just a second, okay, before I go on to the next one. And this one right here is S. You're gonna hear see some words with the S in the front, middle, or even at the end. The S kinda like a just like a helper. I guess you could call that like a helper. You can see that just about anywhere. Okay? But these other characters, they have to have a vowel sound with them, okay? Okay, so line 9 is a D and T sounds. Da, ta, de, te, D, T, do, or to. See, interchangeable. D and T, do, or to, do, or to, duh, or tuh. Remember how those kids say duh, right? They were talking Cherokee. They didn't even realize that, did they? See? There it is. Duh. Okay, now 10 is sometimes it's kind of tricky. DLA and TLA sounds. DL and TL sounds. And let me mention this. The Eastern Band from Cherokee, North Carolina, those areas up there, they don't have the TL sounds. They use the DL sounds. You see? They use TS sounds, actually. They don't even use this line right here. But we here in Western Oklahoma, now we use these. In the Western world, we live this, use these right here. Because I've noticed some of the songs that we sing, they have a DL sound, but they use the TS sounds up there. So, anyway. So if you ever hear that, you'll know what I'm talking about. So line 10 says the DL. So we're in the A column. So it's law. Dlaw. Okay, dlaw, D-L-A sound, dlaw. Okay, then claw, claw, T-L-A sound, claw, claw. Then the tle, or dle, D-L sound too. Tle, and dle, tlo, or dlo. Clue, or dlu. Tla, or dla. Okay, so these are DL and TL sounds. Remember, two characters here, but these just have one. So just keep in mind, these are interchangeable. DL or TL sounds, okay, in the Cherokee language, okay, in our language. Okay, so line 11, sometimes it's kind of hard for some people. Can y'all say saw? It's not actually jaw, like this jaw, but it's saw. Saw. Can y'all say saw? Saw. Not too hard?
Is it like S-A-W?
T-S-T, no, not really. It's more like a, can you say pizza?
Pizza.
See that T-S sound right there? Pizza. Oh. See, I like that sound. That T-S sound like that, pizza. Okay. So it's this. So it's a saw, saw, say, see, so, to, to. Okay, say it one more time. Saw, say, see, so, to, to. Okay, line 12, just regular W sounds. Wa, we, we, wo, wu, wa. See how we're lining them up? A, A, E, O, U, sounds. Okay, all the way across. And line 13, yaw, ye, ye, yo, you, ya. Okay? Hear them sounds? All the way across. A, A, E, O, U, Okay? Now, so I'm going to find yo. What line? What column? Yo. Very good. See? Yaw, ye, ye, yo. There it is. And all I had to do is Y sound, aw, a, e, and o. And that's how you found it. Okay? Two and all, dug all, what? Now, how about a do, do? Find do. Do. Go to your D and T sounds. Nine, what is it?
Four, nine,
one, two, three, four. Close. Five. See, that's O, okay? That's Do, and Do. You were close, though. You were on the right track. You were one step away. But you know how that works, okay? So now, what about a yeah, yeah, yeah. Thirteen-two. There you go. Bingo. No. 13-2. Very good. See? Aw, eh, yaw, yeah. Okay? Very good. Now, what about no? Not yes, but no. Mm-hmm. No. How shall I go? Where long? Where is it written at?
6'4".
That's my height. There you go. No. There you go. And sometimes you can, how you learn some stuff, some people learn by association. They see something that reminds them of these. Me, see this right here? What is that? Law, le, li, lo, lu. You know how I memorized that one? Mary Lou. M. Lou. Mary Lou. That's how I memorized that one when I was first learning. When I was going to that class, that 15-week course I told you about earlier, when I was first learning, man, I tried to put everything in syllabary because I want to learn. Even car tags, I see them. Those billboards on the side of the road, I try to put everything in Cherokee that I could see. Because I was learning. You know, I was even dreaming in Cherokee. No. I was thinking in Cherokee finally. But when I finally took that test, I missed one word. And it was an easy word, turnip. I couldn't even think. Man, Dad grew turnips all alive, you know, and thought, son, I couldn't even think. My mind went blank, and that's the only word I missed in the final test. And when we first got certified, at the end of the course, we had to get tested. And back then, we had to write 2 pages all in Cherokee. And that was a lot of fun. I mean, because I was learning, and man, it was exciting to me, and it still is after, what is it, 15, 16 years now? 16 years. And you'd be amazed once you learn what you can read and write. Because once you learn how to read and write, man, there's no limit what you can do. And what I tell people, what I try to get our elder people, some of them don't know how to read and write, if they can write their own story, you see, just the experience, they can make a little booklet. They can pass it on to your kids, your grandkids, and they can have it, you know. And also you can record yourself, leave for your kids, grandkids. And when I go out and interview elders, so I tell them, a lot of them, they won't do it. I say, well, if I record you, you can pass this on to your kids and grandkids, and they'll always have it. They can make copies as many as they want for the rest of them, you know. See, they always have your voice there. Or if you know the songs, sing them, record them. As long as you're in church, it's a lot of you, huh? You see, all these things. See, one day, our language is going to be gone. I say within, God, next 10 to 20 years, if we're still around, language is going to go way, way down, you see. Like right now, Eastern, man, give you a good example. In North Carolina, in those areas up there, there's less than 300 speakers. Less than 300 speakers. The Anahna, the Kalaga, less than 300 speakers. The adults. They have the emerging kids that are coming up. They're teaching them. But as far as the elders, the older people that can talk Cherokee, less than 300. What about here in Oklahoma? How many do you think we all have around? It's like anyone is. Dorothy. Not that many. Not that many, are there? Not that many at all. Just a few hundred. Just a few hundred people that speaks right here in Oklahoma, you see. And some people claim more, but I always tell them, where are they? Where are they? See, I'm from Jay. I know about how many people from Jay, around Grove, those areas up that way. I know, but just about how many can talk Cherokee. A lot of them understand, but they just can't talk it. You see, they can't speak it. See, how many of you understand in here, but you can't speak it? Anybody? Okay. See, a lot of people are like that. They can understand just about everything, but they can't speak it. They can't talk it. You see, a lot of them do understand. In our Speakers Bureau, first time we met at the council chambers, there was probably stand room only. Then it seated 130 chairs. Everybody's pooling, people standing everywhere. And I asked, how many can read and write? And just about 10, 15 hands out of about 170 people, you see. To me, that's why it's so important for us to learn to read and write, that we can pass on words and stuff, you know, pass on to our people, you know, to a lot of them. You'd be amazed, like I said a while ago, once you learn how to read, just that's why. He's going to go, yeah, to go lead. It's just good, just read in church, you know. Now, let me say this, people who write, sometimes they write a little bit different. It's kind of hard to read when somebody's writing, you know. It's like in English, right? Especially mine. I don't know if you can read my name out there. I signed in a while ago. But anyway, a lot of them write a little bit different. But you see, but once you learn this, and see, boy, I tell you what, it's really, really good. And while ago I said, by association, that is M, Mary Lou, and there's another, that G, a capital A, right? You know how I memorized that one? Ago, long ago. See, capital A, G-O, go, you see. And also this one, that me, capital H. Remember those engines, guys, ladies? Those Hemi engines? That's where I get that, you see. Hemi, that's how I put that together. That's how I memorize that one. And also this, that do. What's that, capital S, right? It makes a do sound. Stew, you see, I memorize that one. Stew. And this one, do, veto, you see? You change the D and T sound, see? Veto. But you can do that too, however you want to do it, just learn. But the key is, no matter how fast or how slow you learn, as long as you're learning, you see? Donna mentioned a while ago, I teach a lot of classes. I've taught a lot of classes throughout the years. But every class is different. See, there's some I go and there's some that speak, some just beginner, all beginners, and so forth. See, there's different people out there, and so I have to teach different ways. Every class that I teach, right now I'm teaching over in the Weber's Falls, and I got to teach it different than those I've taught before. Now, a few can, maybe two or three can speak, the rest of them just now learning. See, you got to teach in different ways. But the thing is, learn how to speak it. Learn how to speak it. I go on here, Diana. You go, and also to hear it. To hear the language. To hear the language. That's the most important thing. You see, because when I was a kid, I learned all our Cherokee songs when I was going to church. I learned them. I couldn't read and write. I learned by hearing, you see. Hearing is very important. I'll tell you what it's like. Dolphy lost an answer like he's a warning. They go, no, it's like he warning. Do the other word. Kill like a warning, it's good. They go, he learned, no, it's like he warning. And I'll start calling. If you hear the word, Cherokee words all the time, before too long, you'll be talking, you see. And there's another example. Here in Tahlequah, there's a lady. She's a white woman, and she can speak Cree. Pretty fluent in Cree. You know how she learned? She learned a Cree man, but when he went off to work, he just left her and her mother-in-law. And her mother-in-law didn't talk English, so she used gestures. And that's how she learned. Now she can talk Cree, you see. Somebody asked me one time, can I talk in Creek? I said, no, but I can talk from the bank. No. No, you can delete that, all right? But anyway, but this is very important to learn our language, and you can, like I said, you can pass it on and write stories, and you can write your own story about your biography or autobiography, however you want to do, you know, and write about yourself. That way your kids can always have, you know, and write little stories, you know, and things that happened. One time over here in the Speaker's Bureau, we did that, and we somewhat, just right what happened this morning. This one guy wrote, so now I had that idea, huh? They didn't know that, though, didn't know you ladies, and I wanted that. You didn't know that, I'm going to do that. Anyway, this one guy said, this morning I woke up and I was going, went to the bathroom, going to brush my teeth, and I remember I didn't have no teeth. So stories like that. So you can write stuff like that and pass it on to your kid, you know, or whatever you want to do. But again, all these are six vowel sounds. All, a, e, o, u, and you just make up words. As you, if I let me give you a three character word, okay? I want you to find that. You can write this down if you want to. You can write down in the for practice. You can write in the phonetics. You can write phonetics. You're on that case. Oh, hell on. Then later go out and go back and find it was a syllable. Practice like that. And if you know somebody that speaks Cherokee, get together with them and say, give me some Cherokee words. I want to practice my syllable. Or if you're a speaker yourself and you don't know how to read and write, write down in English what you know. And here's what I want you to get, okay? I want you to write this. So, qui, li. So, qui, li. Okay? See if you can find that in the syllable chart, just for practice. So, go to your S's on the left side. Find your S's, then match it up. All, A, E, O. And you'll find it. Okay? And what does it look like? It'll be this. Kind of looks like a cactus. So, in the qui, go to your Q's. Qua, que, qui. Okay? Then it looks like this. Qui. Okay? And your L sounds, li, la, le, li. Should be third one over. Nil. Looks like this. So, qui, li. And that means horse. That means horse. Okay? So, qui, li. And that's how you make words. And here's another one. Write this down. G-cli. G-cli. So go to your G and K sounds all around the left side and go all, A, E. Right here. All, A, E. So it'd be this one right here, the Y looking character. That'd be G, okay? That's G. Be like this. Gi, and that sli, so claw, clay, sli. Should be in third column. Right here. Claw, Klekli. Okay? So it's a C. Much like a capital C. Okay? Kli. Gihli. And what is that?
Dog.
Okay? I always like to tell a story that Durbin Feeling told me one time. He said he was teaching class one time, and all the students, they learned dog, Gihli. And so they went. He took them on a field trip. They was going down the road in a van or whatever they was in. Dog ran in front of them. Said, and that one of the women in the class said, "Man, we almost run over that YC." So she caught on to how to spell it. We don't know why I see, so she learned her syllabary now, so you can do that now. I was thinking about that when we were teaching class now. And there's a word that we use. I want you to write it down. Has-di. 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 Can you find that? Go to your H's on the left side. Be line 3, ha, he. It'd be that one right there, okay? He. And you write it like something like this. And that's he. Then the S. Sometimes it's kind of hard to write, isn't it? The S. 8, 1, B, okay? S. I make my S like this. S, I make my circle. Go up, come back around, line through there. Okay, that's the S. He, s, the S sound. Then D, make it like this, just come back around, up, back down, D. He, sti, he, sti, he, sti. Stop, stop, quit, don't, that kind of word. There's another story. I was teaching a class in J one time. There's a guy said, there's a story one time. There's a, talking about Hesty. So there's a Indian woman and a white woman talking. And the Indian woman had a little grandson running around everywhere. You know how kids do. You know how boys get into everything. And every now and then she'd say, Hesty, Hesty. And they keep talking. And she turned around, Hesty. Telling the boy, so after a while, he said, how old is Hesty? Yeah. Mine was also, mine was Hasla Wayne. Be quiet. No. But see, there's stories like that, and I hear every now and then. But, so find a, give you a simple one. Where song. Where song. Go to W's. So, way down the bottom. Line 12, second one over, that's way, okay? I'll make that something like this. Let me write phonetically first. B. Now be careful when you write that way, because that whoa next to it is something like that, isn't it? So the way comes down bottom, goes up. Bottom, go up like that. Because whoa stays on top, okay? So be careful how you write that. No, bring an eraser. So, way is something like that. Did you find way? Okay, how about saw? Did you find saw? Saw, the upside down A? Way, saw. Way, saw. And what is that? A cat. Very good. Do y'all know what a kamama is? And what is it? Or elephant. And why was that, you think?
Ears.
The ears? Man, y'all are pretty good. Man, y'all are way ahead of me. Okay. Now.
A number?
How about colors? Y'all know the colors? Y'all don't know them? Okay. There's a. Let me. Uh-oh. You, I'm in trouble now. I knew that was going to happen. But anyway, God damn. Remember, I used to work with a lady years ago. She'd find out when one of her kids said, "What do you want?" She never would say hello or so with you and "What do you want?" Y'all know this used to be a club, right? Years ago. I went around here when that was, but they said it was. But anyway, any questions on the syllabary or what you might want to know?
I had a class one time and that last column they pronounced it different. You saying duh?
Uh-huh.
And say dumb. I said, I don't know if it was the instructor or if that was a different dialect that they were using. Or
it's probably the instructor. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it's not really duh. The H sound, it's just duh. Duh. I mean, it can be, depending on the trick you work. But it's just DV, duh. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Kind of yeah.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, some of them do that. They have different ways of saying some stuff. And yeah.
One is, I know a Cherokee speaker, and I only know a few phrases from, like, Sohiju. Instead of saying
Osta, he says Osta. Osta. Same thing. It's good.
Same thing.
Same thing. He says it a little bit different. The Eastern man, that asks you Osta. Same thing. Osta. Are you okay? Are you good? Osta. Okay. Only they say Osta. That's what they say. Osta. That's what they say. Yeah. So Osta, Osta. No. Are you okay? Are you doing good? Osta. Yeah.
If you want to say real good.
Ujadost. Ujadati means more than good, what you're saying. Ujadost, what they say. Or sometimes you might hear it this way too. Utehti. I'm doing real good, real fine. Utehti. So there are different ways of saying stuff like that. Yeah. So don't let that throw you off. So, orsa means good. Okay. Or if somebody say Osiju, same thing. Are you okay? Are you good? You know? Now when somebody say Tohiju, now that's a bit different. I know everybody say, "Are you? How are you doing?" They say Osiju Tohiju. They say, "Hello, how are you?" But actually, they say, "Hello, are you well? Are you well?" You see, they're not saying, "How are you?" Actually, they're saying, "Are you well?" What they're saying, Tohiju. You see, Toha, Shingaste. A lot of them use duh with how are you. Now, do you know any greetings, any parting remarks or anything like that? Long time ago, I was teaching the class last night, I told them this, that long time ago, we'd visit one another, when we used to do things like that, long time ago, I remember those. We're always on the go anymore. We don't have time to visit. But long time, we'd go to somebody's house, they'd come over, and when they were leaving, they would say, You did all line. You all come again. You all come back. You all come again. That's what they're saying. So you can say y'all in Cherokee. You did all line. Y'all. But let me write it up. Nobody can have it. Or I'll write it the different ways I wrote it last night. Let me kind of erase some of that stuff here. Some parting remarks. Okay, now for one person, you would write, you want me to write syllabary or phonetics? Both? Both? I was hoping you wouldn't say that. No. Okay. Be e he do. Wait, let me make that better. La e he do la e e he do la e. That means for one person. I mean, you come again. or you come back again, how you want to say that. You come back again. What do you come again? You head the line. See? Then, for two people, be you stay at the line. Wait, sorry. What would be that? E stay to the I'm not smaller and smaller now, you know. You stay at the line. I mean, you stay at the line. You and the person are leaving somewhere. They have to come back or come back and visit. You stay at the line. You two come again. You stay at the line. Then for three or more, I'm going to put three plus, okay? That means three or more. It means E, Tse, Do, La, E. E, Tse, Do, La, E. Okay? See these words right here? Those are what we call the root of the word, the stem of the word. And this right here. Tells how many. Okay. No, sorry. I left this one out. Ihe. That means one. Ihe do line. Iste means two. Iste do line. Ite means three or more people. Oh, put left this side in there. There you go. Ite. See? Do line means come back. Ite. So that means one, two, or three people. Ite do line. You hear do line. You stay do line. Ite do line. See? One, two, and three or more. Okay? Okay? Or if I said, and here's the first, second, third person. Somebody read that one. Anybody? Agiyosi. Ask one. No. Says, I'm hungry. I said, me too.
You had learned that one.
Oh, yeah.
That's an important one.
Oh, yeah. You got to know that one. Agiyosi. That's first person, okay? That's you. Then second person would be Tsa Yosi. You are hungry. Then for third person it'd be Uyosi. See, in Turkey, we don't even think about these things. We say it. I mean, because it's in our minds, you know, that we say that. But when we're teaching Turkey, we have to bring these out for second, third person, and which one says how many, and so forth. And actually, we do have a book nowadays that we came up with, and with the help of a bunch of them, we got together, and we're going to try to make a beginners, intermediate, and advanced courses. What we're going to do, and our boss suggested earlier that we might, when we teach in a community, we might go there three times to teach all of those, like a 10-week course, beginners, intermediate, and advanced. So we're going to see how that's going to work out. So that'd be pretty good. Because usually when I go somewhere, I like to go to that place at least twice anyway. But then with these books, I might have to go back three times. I don't know how I might get tired of them, though. No. That's what they told me. Don't get tired of it. So, anyway. So, this is the first, second, third person. Agiyosi. Like myself, Agiyosi. Tayosi. Uyosi. See, first, second, third person. You see? It's going to make it to lock it. Tell me, you do one thing, you're going to throw it all. You get wasted. See? When we was growing up, if you're immersed in your language, like most of them talk English, right? See, they didn't teach you, they didn't sit down and teach you English, did they? They spoke it to you. Same thing in Cherokee, too. They didn't teach us. Because a while ago I mentioned that sometimes mom and dad be talking about something. I didn't really understand what they were talking about. One time, mom and dad was sitting outside on the porch, and I was inside listening to what they were saying. I was eavesdropping, I guess. Anyway, they were talking about lawyers and judges, and they're talking about law terms. And they were talking about skidana, the yaga law, Susan, what they were saying. And I was thinking to myself, I said, man, could they put their own shoes on? Because in English, you make it sound like, I mean, Cherokee, it sounds like somebody's going to put the shoe on them. And they're going to sue them, is what they were saying. And they're talking about lawyers, dityonhe. And they were talking about that. I said, golly, I wonder why they was arguing. That's the word for lawyer, dityonhe, the one who argues for you. That was it. And they used all these terms. I didn't know what they were saying. But later on, I never did ask them what they were talking about. I just figured out later on what they were talking about when I got a little bit older. So they was like that too sometimes. And some words now, one of my coworkers come up with some words. I said, I think you just make those words up, do you? I said, huh? But he knows those older words. He really does. He doesn't. So I have to ask him what he's talking about sometimes when I haven't heard him. I'm sure mom and dad knew him a long time ago, but when I was growing up, as I got older, I started using less and less Cherokee. When I was growing up in high school, I still understood everything, but as far as speaking it, it kind of got harder and harder to speak it. Then when I started for Cherokee Nation, I left Jay, come down here, and I started to hear more Cherokee, and then I started learning more and more, and especially now that the work that I do, the radio program, I'd go out and interview elders, then I really had to learn. And one of the things I tell everybody, a simple word, I heard one of the first people I interviewed over in Nycutt, and he said this word, Diagigalis. He said, Diagigalis. I thought, man, I couldn't even say it. I knew what he was saying, because his mother-in-law was already cutting up while he was interviewing. She's making jokes about him. Then that's what he said. Diagigalis. She's making fun of me. That's what he was saying. And I had to go back to the office. Now, this is my tape. I had cassette tapes back then. I had back in there about listening four or five times before I could find to say it. I knew, let's hear you, Westy. Diagigalis. Once I learned it, then it was back. So I didn't forget it after that. But I hadn't heard that in such a long time. I forgot how to say it. My tongue wouldn't wag the right way. It was English-fied. No. So that's what happens to a lot of people. When they don't use the language, they know what somebody's saying, but their tongue can't turn right, and they can't say it. I have a cousin right now. She can understand about everything you say, but she can't say it. She said, I'm afraid I'm going to say it wrong when I try to say it. And my wife's like that, too. She can read and write Cherokee probably better than I can, but she doesn't talk it that much. But some words she's comfortable saying, she'll say it probably better than I can. But as far as her really speaking out, she understands everything, but she's afraid she'll say something wrong. Give you a good example. One year, oh, I'm running out of gas. They had this written. Wait. Sorry. They had this written right here. When I was working in the mailroom, they had a stack about like that. Colored copy, and they were kind of expensive back then when they first started coming out. They still are, but they were probably more expensive back then. And I asked that girl that was making the coffee, I said, why are you standing out? And it's from the administration, chief, deputy chief, and the council member. They're sending those out to the people. And it says this, Uli he listi, ta zi sta yo he hai. I said, why are you standing out? It's supposed to be Merry Christmas. And I said, no, that's not what you're saying. And it says, they're happy that someone's being shot at. And this one little thing right here, if you take this off, it's supposed to be in that. Merry Christmas. But there's some thoughts these to your hands on being shot at. And the one little character right here, see how it is? That Z, this one, and knee. See? That little character makes all the difference in the world. Change the whole meaning of that word. It's one little character.
I don't remember what it's supposed to mean, but they had something about a chicken in it.
Oh, okay. I know what you're talking about. It's this. So that's the logia, actually. Right there. The togia, actually. Chicken Nation.
Chief Joe Bird had that on his jacket, Chintagi. In the parade.
Oh, yeah.
I couldn't stop him. I was going to stop him.
See that law and taw. Cross the line, the law, change the taw. Okay. And actually, I went to one of the clinics in the Cherokee Nation. I was reading that, and that's what they had on there. Did you know? I told them that's wrong. I said, oh my goodness, is that wrong? I said, yeah, they're talking about Cherokee Chicken Nation. They didn't give out coins one time. We were from the Chicken Nation. The toggy, actually, and I got the lantern to go with. God, that man. Oh my goodness. Broiled. No. Yeah. But it's they can make a mistake like it. And over there in the at the complex, it's like this. Let's see. That. You know where the bricks are? When you drive up there by the flags, where the bricks are, the big sign, it's written like this. And that's wrong. You see, this means a yesli. That means middle, center, or 50 cents. See, this is a nation right here. A yesli. See? Our elders, they read like this. A yeah. They heard the H sound right there in the middle. Ayehli. Ayehli. But nowadays, we had that dog woggle. Remember that? YC. Geehli. But actually, the elders heard it like this. H sound right there. Geehli. Geehli. But nowadays, they hear geehli. They emphasize at the back end of it. Geehli. But actually, it's written like that in the Bible. 2 years ago, well, in the Bible. That's what our elders heard a long time ago. See, a lot of words that we can, I've noticed too in the writing, from the old people, from back in 1800 and before that, they used a lot of those, that li, instead of chli, they used a lot of those words like that because they heard the H sound right there in the middle. Yeah. So that's where they make a mistake sometimes. So that sign, I don't know how many times I've told him about that. Chief on down. And it's still there. So I'm about ready to quit. No. Delete that, all right? Yeah. I don't know. I'm going like, hey, where's my 50 cents? I was like, yes, me. Yeah. Here's an old word. In Cherokee, Talianaga, yes. Have you all heard that? He's saying, Talianaga, yes. Tell him what it is. Tell him what it is. No. Actually, it's a dollar and a half. Talianaga, yes. Talianaga, yes. Talianaga, yes. And it means a half of the second one. North, yes, dollar and a half, dollar percent, yeah, tall now, yes, tall you now, second, half of the second one, we're saying tall you now, yes, dollar and a half, that's what I mean, dollar and a half. remember a long time ago, we drive up in the gas station. Dad said, "Oh, you have to go to Sligi. Put in 50 cents worth." We did that now. We'd run down, we'd run out of gas right down the road, wouldn't we? But anyway, there's a story that Dad used to tell us. There's a man, when it was a full service station a long time ago, a man drove up in there and said, asked for some gas, and the attendant put gas in for him and said, after put the gas in, the guy said, "How's your oil?" I said, "Okay, how are you all?" I was wondering if that was Dad that did that. It might have been him. But anyway, any more questions about the language or anything that you've come across so far? And if you have, Dorothy can answer it for you.
What about family history? When you go back to the names of our ancestors, you know, and mm-hmm. My wife's family name is Chukalay. Did that mean anything? Or has it been messed up over the years to where it used to, but doesn't anymore?
Yeah, a lot of names were changed, actually. They really were, because what they did was when the European came over, they would ask some other names in church because they couldn't talk. They might have just understood what they were saying, the name, but they couldn't say it right, and they wrote down what they heard. That's where a lot of our names were changed. Because actually, I think, myself, my last name, Six Killer, it's a... Suzal Dihi. And Dihi, see, that's just like a killer. That's what it means. And this up here means just six, okay? So six killer. But Dihi, Tihi, Dihi, Tihi. To me, I think their names will change from killer to Tihi. See, Dihi, Tihi. I mean, I think, I'm not sure, I can't prove it, but I'll tell you, a lot of our names are changed like that. And I can tell you some names, but I don't want them recorded. But yeah, I think a lot of our names were lost like that, even last names. And even right now, like the Gourds, they cut their name in half. They used to be Rattling Gourds. Studi, Tune Studi, and all like that. Field, Old Field. You know, so there's Fields, Old Fields, same family. Studi, Tune Studi, same family. And see, but I'm going to keep my name as it is, all right? I don't want to be a killer, just a killer, or a six. I'm going to be a six killer, okay?
Would you
any more?
Persimmon and Cherokee.
Okay. Oh, that's an easy one. Saul Lee. Persimmon.
I say.
Saul Lee. S-A-L-I. Mm-hmm. It's a... Saul Lee. That's persimmon. Speaking of which, you all know that when you open up a seed of persimmon, there's a knife or a fork or a spoon, all right? And what does that mean, Dorothy?
They say, I've heard, I don't really know, if there's like all three, that it's going to be a bad weather.
Mm-hmm.
They
said it snowed last week, just right down the road, up Kansas. Lillian, Anna, said it's really snowing quite a bit, right there in Kansas. Didn't do anything here, but rain here. Yeah.
My church name is Skoy. How would you write that?
Bug?
Yeah.
Don't bug me. Probably... See. Skoye, I think it would be. But there's a, to me, there's a TS sound that I hear whenever I say Skoye. Mm-hmm. It's getting away, isn't it?
Skoye, if you sit down.
Skoye.
Skoye, if it's way over there.
Mm-hmm. Skoye, yeah. So there's a TS sound right here. Could be like that. There's a TSI. Skoye. 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 It could be one of these. It could be this one too, right here. Skoye. Skoye. Like that. Okay. Skoye. 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 A lot of times, our churchy words, like a yawn, we drop the vowel sound at the end, yawn, so it yawny or yawna, you see. It's got to be, it's not that they're just not one end sound by itself. They got to have a vowel sound to it. But a lot of our churchy words, we drop the vowel sounds. Like, especially our numbers, you mentioned numbers a while ago. Sagwa, tali, zoi, naki, hiski, sudali, koskogi, tanela, sonela, skohi. But a speaker would say, Sawa tall, zotna, ki, sudo. So they drop the vowel sound at the end. So we'd say it that way. Mm-hmm. If you listen to the radio program, I do that a lot. I didn't realize it, but I do. I just say the numbers, I don't add the vowel sound at the end. You see? And sometimes the 800 number, especially at the end of the program, I say, Nelitsk. That's 800 in Cherokee, another way of saying it. Instead of saying, Tuneli Skohitsk, Nelitsk is 800, you see? I'll say it that way sometimes.
Yeah, Dennis, once I learned the Cherokee vowels, gosh, almost 15 years ago from you, I have to think of the English vowels now.
Mm-hmm.
I really have to, somebody asked me to put some things in, where you can read it.
Uh-huh.
I can read it easier.
Uh-huh.
The Cherokee, and I had to really think about English vowels. I didn't know what they sounded like. Even though I speak English, I hadn't.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this really
kind of
takes the place of that.
Mm-hmm.
In your
yeah.
Mind
yeah.
You really learn it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's really good. Cause in other words, once you learn it, keep it up.
Yeah.
Or else you might forget about them. If you don't use it, you lose it. Yeah. You will. Really will.
How do you know what syllables to accent? And it sounds like Cherokee kind of goes up and down.
It does. Mm-hmm.
How do you know when to do that?
You just have to hear it. That's the only way I can tell you, because there's really no set ways. But that book that we were talking about, it does give clues on that, and I mean, but really the put the marks here and there. But it's kind of like you said, agiosi. And I knew this one girl when I was in that language class when I was learning. She could read, but she didn't read in monotone. It's almost just a level, you see. But then, when you're speaking, I don't know where to put the pitches, you know, and stuff. You know, it's the pitches and the all that kind of stuff. You know.
Was
but yeah, they worked on it for a while, but I don't know what it become of it, because there'd be a lot of markings in the book,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
But the key is to hear it.
Yeah.
It's to hear it. It really is, and that's the only way I can say it, because actually, you might want to call, I don't know what you think about it, but you can ask him, Roy Boney, write his name down, Roy Boney, because that book that we have, there's a website, all those words in that book are recorded, the words and phrases are all recorded, so you might ask him for that link if he's willing to share it with you.
We'll look for it and share it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, Dennis, too, I'm one of the ones that my mom and dad, my grandma, grandpa spoke Cherokee in the home. We all lived together, too. But they didn't speak to us in Cherokee, so the kids didn't learn it. But I can still hear them speaking and those really emphasize those sounds.
Mm-hmm.
So when I feel for learning things, I almost kind of know where to emphasize.
Mm-hmm.
I already kind of know how to say it. Even though I may not even know what I'm saying. It's the strangest thing, because it is kind of like a song, and I just kind of still remember that.
Because you heard it growing up.
Heard the song part of it.
Mm-hmm.
I never really knew what they were saying.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really something that you just have to kind
of do. Another good example I can give too, it's about hearing it. My grandkids, when they were younger, about 3 or 4 year olds, and maybe not that long ago, but anyway, they stayed over at Katua daycare. They stayed there all summer, and that girl, or the woman that was watching them, she played those church and I used choir CDs all summer long. Then one day, we went to, took the kids, the grandkids to Branson. On the way back, me and my wife started singing Cherokee. Those kids just fell in right behind us. I turned around and said, y'all know these songs? I said, where'd y'all learn them? They said, over at Katua Daycare. Because they heard them all summer long. And man, they knew a song. They knew a song. I said, well, y'all sing one. And it was funny. My granddaughter, she's funny. She said, yeah, okay, I'll start singing. She started singing, and she got a high pitch, and he said, take it over, Devin. That's her brother. She said, take it over. When they were singing in Cherokee, they asked one, that's where they learned, by hearing it. They can't read and write, but they learned that song, and man, they sang it real good. Yeah. Better than I did. I was ashamed. Yeah, to hear. Actually, right now, what Roy said the other day was the CDs are becoming obsolete now. Did you know that? But to me, they're not. But you can stick a CD in there and drive down the road, listen all day long, church, you know, if you had a CD of something, huh?
I think it's because those younger kids, what they do is they download things. Mm-hmm. So they have, like, on their smartphones, they'll download stuff and they'll have to use it on their phone.
Yeah, oh yeah, they...
When you go to iTunes.
Oh yeah. No, they got all that kind of stuff. And when I first started doing the radio program, which was 12 years ago, almost 13 now, I started with cassette tapes. It was a Tahlequah station right here. I just go up there and run tape up there and come back and talk to those people up there. And later on, I went to CDs. Then a few years down the road, then they grab it offline now. I don't even see those people anymore. Could be good in a way. No, but anyway. I used to talk to them. I knew them. But now when you see them, they all do is upload on computer, on the internet, and they grab it, and that's it. And I don't even talk to them anymore. See? You know, that's what the world's coming to. That's why we don't visit one another. You can phone. You know, you can text. You can all this kind of stuff. You know, the lack of communication now, here and there now. Because that's what the world's coming to, isn't it?
Really?
High tech stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because a long time ago, like I said a while ago, we stayed two days. We played with the kids and everything, and also we played outside then. And also, if you think about it, there was less diabetes, less heart attacks, because we was moving. We was running, we was playing, you know. And nowadays, kids have diabetes, don't they? Little kids have diabetes.
They're worrying more now, like the little kids, about their socialization and their vocabulary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so the kids aren't developing the way they should.
Mm-hmm.
They're not being interactive.
Mm-hmm. And also, single parents, because there's not a balance there, see, that can happen too. I remember when our daughter was little, actually, our daughter, she's 36 now, I think 35. But anyway, when she was little, my wife used to read to her while she was pregnant. She'd read to the baby. And when she grew up, by the age of one, she was already talking in sentences. Everybody was amazed. Said, God, she can talk? I said, yeah. So we've been talking like an adult since she's a baby. And then she had books, and she had them all memorized. Those little books, those little story books, you know, she had them memorized. And somebody come over, or she started reading to them. She'd be going like, she's had them memorized. And said, she can read? I said, no, she's had them memorized. She had made those people, know, but she couldn't read, but she could talk though. She could really talk. We gave her a present. Age of one, said, "Is this my present?" She said, "She just talking." What's the good one? No neck, nothing. But you see, our kids can catch on to the language pretty quick. They can catch on pretty quick because they haven't learned a whole lot of things yet, different things. Because their mind is like a sponge; it absorbs it. You know, see. We teach our kids, get them at a young age, but immersion, sometimes they have a problem over there too, because when they get back home, the parents don't speak Cherokee. That's like a new word, you get like a young age, like when Zoe's on him, when I kiss, you know. I remember one time I was around some immersion kids, and we went on a trip somewhere, and I forget where it was at, and they said, well, we don't talk Cherokee now, our teacher's not here. That's the way they think, you know, sometimes. And on the outside of the campus over there, they don't want to talk Cherokee. They really won't. I don't know why that is. It's just a, I get that set environment. they're more comfortable among their peers, I guess.
The Mickey that goes to the little head, or the little head care part over there.
The circle?
Yeah, mm-hmm. The circle, and they are teaching them words and stuff. And,
mm-hmm.
But when they get home, you know, my nephew, my brother and them,
mm-hmm.
they don't, you know, if they don't know it,
mm-hmm.
they don't get to practice with mm-hmm. them or anything either.
Mm-hmm.
They don't know what they're saying if they say it.
Yeah. 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 But I know what you're saying right here about the sounds, the pitches. It's hard if you're not a speaker. I mean, it'd be like that for me to learn another language, you know. I'd have to hear it. Me, I'd have to hear it. I'd have to hear it and probably see it too, you know. The word and remember how somebody said it. That's the key to the language, any language that I know of is to hear it. I'll tell you what, you know. Can't hardly hear it sometimes, the language, you know. But anyway, any more questions, anything?
I think our tech guy is ready to wrap us up.
Okay. All right.
Dennis, I really enjoy this. And
mm-hmm.
I really
thank you.
He's one of the best teachers out there.
Yeah.
And, I'd like to do this again.
Mm-hmm.
I know you stay busy, though, but maybe if I get a request in early enough,
mm-hmm.
I would love to have you come teach.
Mm-hmm.
And our at-large citizens, too. That's kind of what's got me going on this, because,
mm-hmm.
again, wanted me to translate some things in how we would say them in Cherokee.
Uh-huh.
And even though I'm not a speaker, I know the syllabary chart. I
uh-huh.
memorized the syllabary chart.
Uh-huh.
But I couldn't remember the English ballad.
Uh-huh.
That was the hardest
uh-huh.
part. That's what took me the longest.
Uh-huh.
So, and I thought we should really kind of start with this,
uh-huh.
how to read the chart and how the sounds are really kind of different sometimes
uh-huh.
than what
uh-huh.
we think they are. So.
Yeah.
But, we really appreciate it, Dennis.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for being here.
Mm-hmm. Well done. Mm-hmm. Well done. Y'all are a good audience. Don't you have to tell anybody in the corner.
I
know. You know what our turkey name is? Boss.
Oh.
That's our turkey name. Do you call us?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Boss.
I'll have to remember that.